Greetings, Guardians. My name is Byf here. Okay, so today we're going to be breaking down the new trailer for the season of The Chosen that has just dropped here and now. There's going to be a lot to talk about in this one, so expect another long video out of 2 minutes worth of stuff, mainly because, again, I like to go into the lore of things and explain everything that's going on. For those of you who have not seen anything with regards to this, this is an official Bungie trailer, so I'm going to go ahead and say, if you want to be spoiled of anything, then you came to the right place. However, if you don't want to be spoiled of detail, then yeah, go ahead and jump out of this video right now. If the thumbnail is there, I'm going to use just the expansion art that Bungie has posted as well. So don't worry, no spoilers in that regard. It's just literally what is out there in public domain. Anyway, with all that said, let's go ahead and jump in and see what's going on in this trailer. So, where do we start with this? Very obvious thing. The Hive God was driven back. Her influence still lingers as a new threat emerges. Well, that new threat is Keitel, which we'll talk about in a moment. She is a very important character. But the Hive God in question, of course, was Shuvua Wrath, whose Wrathborn and the High Celebrant of those Wrathborn was defeated in the last season. She is still around, and that I think is going to be very relevant for the plot coming forward. And something very interesting to note about all of that is, of course, how that's going to interact between not just her and Keitel, but also her, Keitel, and Savathun. Savathun, I think, is the beneficiary of all this chaos. Savathun basically gets to throw around all these different factions in the system to create all of this different disunified fighting. And she is basically just going to be able to come along a little bit like a vulture and scavenge across the remains if she plays her cards right. Also, this may not happen. I hope it happens. I'm just going to say this just in case there's a Bungie employee here on the narrative team who's listening and wants to do this. I hope all of this leads to them. And when I say them, I mean not just Keitel, but also Shuvua Wrath and any other forces that we interact with, being relevant in the size and scale of the Witch Queen expansion. Because if so, that is an amazing way to link these otherwise what seem to be divergent storylines together so that they are coherent. Keep in mind, we have had Shuvua Wrath and now we have Keitel. That's a Cabal storyline and a Hive storyline. And yeah, they seem somewhat different thus far. Shuvua Wrath I can see absolutely linking into Witch Queen. Keitel, I could see linking into Witch Queen if she becomes a more persistent actor in the next couple of seasons. We need to see how that goes, but this is a reminder and a hope. Please link the seasonal stories together. This was my number one thing that I critiqued previously. Some other small things in this frame. We've not seen whatever the hell these things are ever since the city fell during the Red War. They are giant, what looks like Cabal battle carriers of some kind. And it's very clear that they are, you know, just a larger modification of ship than the typical Cabal battleships here. And of course, you see them flying Keitel's blue and white banners, the banners of the Princess Imperial, as it turns out these are. You can see her logo on all of this, so it's very clear that she brought a really significant sized fleet to aid in her attack. Or, well, I wouldn't say attack immediately. Why? Well, let's go ahead and find out.
The darkness crowds the edges of this system. The Hive serves it. You'll fall to one, if not the other. I propose an alliance. With my army and your light, the Cabal will crush the Hive. Bow.
No.
So, where do we start with this? Well, I think we start with our leading lady. This is Keitel, the Princess Imperial, daughter of Emperor Kallus and one of the conspirators of the Midnight Coup. She was one of the ones who helped Dominus Gaul to rise to power and allowed him to become the very first Dominus of the Cabal, beyond his station as the Ghost Primus of the Red Legion, beyond his station as a simple military commander, she allowed him to rise to the rank of dictator. And the reason for that is because she believed that her father, Emperor Kallus, with all of his decadence and opulence, was weak. Keitel represents this really weird nexus of Cabal power within the system. And the reason for that is because she can represent both sides of the coin for the Cabal loyalties. For the Red Legion, for anyone who was loyal to the Dominus, for anybody who was loyal to the Cabal without Kallus, she represents Gaul's best intentions to a certain extent, to serve as a strong military figure for the Empire and to unite them with strength. She most certainly commands all of that respect because of the Midnight Coup. In the meantime, there is still a little bit of pull, thanks to her royal blood, with anybody who previously might have served Kallus. And if Kallus ever does fall, it may be the case that the Cabal that were under his command, those who now sit aboard the Leviathan, wherever it may have gone, are now potentially going to be in a position where they might serve her. That is, again, if Kallus dies. They are at odds. They have always been at odds. Kallus and his daughter's relationship is a little bit like, well, some family relationships, I suppose, in the sense that they could not be more opposite from each other. He consistently attempted to ensure that she was as close to what we might imagine a classical princess as possible. She was not interested in poetry and pageantry, however, she was interested in becoming a pilot, and in learning the ways of combat and learning the ways of strategy. And the way that this all manifested itself was in her friendship with another one of the conspirators of the Midnight Coup, the Evkut General Umunarath, the Primus of all legions, another female Cabal, incredibly competent commander, someone who was able to take Keitel under her wing, and someone who would, at the end of the day, also talk to her about the growing threats to the Cabal Empire, threats that Keitel now sees head-on with the Darkness. This is where all of the interesting nexus of power really aligns, though, because when it comes to Keitel, she is most definitely one of those figures that is able to do it all, you know? She is able to hold the imperial title whilst also undoubtedly being a formidable combatant and a wise leader all at the same time. She is the real deal, and as far as Cabal storylines go, she is one of two female characters that I think has a huge impact going forward, the second of which I will talk about later. I don't think I need to talk much about why this alliance between her and the Tower fails. Much as it is true that the Cabal and the Guardians united could be a powerful force, there is a major thing stopping that from happening. Well, really a major thing that happened quite some time ago, and that is, of course, that her father brought the Tower to its knees and she asked Commander Zavala in the process of forming the alliance to bow. Yeah, that wasn't going to work. That was never going to work. You think that you could invade the Tower and that you could make people bow to you? It's crazy. Anyway, yeah. Keitel is here. She means business, and the alliance that she proposes fails and is a non-starter, thanks to the, well, I wouldn't even say they'd need to negotiate, thanks to the common sense of Zavala and Osiris, who undoubtedly sat here, and whilst they would have considered an alliance like this behind gritted teeth, the moment they were asked to bow would have probably said, hell no, and we do indeed see that in the trailer. So we're going to be facing off against some new Cabal forces, and we're going to talk about how we're going to face them after watching the next segment.
Empress Keitel has emerged as the new face of their empire and demanded I pledge loyalty to her.
This tank is like a living thing. She breathes, she moves, and she will spit out your bones.
So, we'll cut it there for the moment, because I need to show you guys this. These scenes here, where you can see above the city, and you see all this almost pageantry from the surroundings. This is a new location in Destiny, but not one that is too unfamiliar to us. This new location is known as the Helm, and this is a spaceport, apparently, a spaceport upon which we will be setting up our battle table, which you can see there in the background. and it is a place where we can start to plan the war against Keitel. You can also see all of what I believe is the fully ranked seasonal armor for this season. You know, you've got Warlock, Hunter, and Titan, and before anyone else thinks it, yes, it's a sloth face. It's absolutely a sloth face. I'm so sad about the Warlock armor being yet more balls randomly sitting on things. But yeah, no, you've got all these new weapons too, by the looks of things. Very interesting. I love the design of this. Is that linear fusion? It's either a linear fusion or it's a pulse. I think it's a linear fusion. You can see the battery down there. Anyway, point being, from the helm here, there's inevitably going to be some story moments and some story elements. It's not clear what the gameplay purpose of it is, but regardless, I think the helm is going to be one of those background systems that we visit, and I think it's really cool to take a look at this because it mirrors the old Vanguard meeting room. You know, the Vanguard Hall back in the tower, and I don't mean the Tower of Destiny 2, I mean the Tower of Destiny 1. This is some old school referential visual design for true Destiny 1 veterans. Anyway, with all that said, let's move on. This is the Moving Fortress. This appears to be, well, the location of the new strike. I think this might be a land tank, an Imperial land tank, not sitting outside of Rubicon this time. The meme kind of lives, and it makes sense that Keitel has a moving fortress much like this. It makes sense that it's on Nessus. There are a lot of Cabal that are on Nessus or in Nessus's general domain because of everything that's happened with Kallus there and all of the Red Legion operations that have been taken in that general direction. So it's unsurprising that Keitel would assert her military dominance both here and at Earth. This is inevitably going to be a target of opportunity, just in the same way that Vallastar Ark was, just in the same way that any Cabal strike boss is. This is going to be something that we are going to have to go through and attack. Also, of course, just to give you an idea of the scale of this thing, this is probably inside said land tank. Yeah, there is a tank inside the tank, and there are even smaller. Interceptors aren't really tanks, they're kind of a Cabal's version of a Sparrow, I suppose. Regardless, point being, we're in for an interesting time here inside this one. And something else I want to go ahead and show you, if we can get a decent shot at it, this is very clearly some of the little bit of opulence that Keitel has decided to adopt from her father's side of things. This boss here is kind of interesting and unique, and there's a reason why, if I can get the frame right. Which maybe I can, maybe I can't, I don't know. Sort of. You can see some clipping in the frame here from the trailer. There is another better frame, I believe. Just a little bit around if we take a look at everything correctly. I'm trying to show off the fact that it's a female Cabal, basically. There are tusks here, is the important point. This is actually a decent enough frame for it. This is really interesting, because this is most certainly not Keitel herself. I can, practically speaking, guarantee that it would almost certainly not be Keitel. She'll probably be giving commentary throughout the strike, but I don't believe for a second that this is Keitel. And the reason for that is because I don't believe that they would be so foolish as to simply make Keitel a strike boss. I think you're going to be looking at what is clearly one of Keitel's chosen champions here. Keitel, by allowing the champion to keep her tusks, is demonstrating something really interesting, because we don't know culturally whether the Cabal military generally allow that. We don't know a lot about Cabal society, and we've never seen their troops with tusks before. So it's going to be a really interesting question of what does this mean with regards to questions about Cabal military service for female Cabal. So yeah, it's really unclear. You know, is it one of these things of we've seen female Cabal, which I believe we have in the European aerial zone. We've seen a pair of sister colossi. Is it just the case that they have to shave down their tusks ahead of military service? Is it one of these things of, well, only certain female Cabal will actually grow tusks? Is this kind of a rank thing? Is this something to do with lineage, perhaps? Is it something to do with a new wave of culture that Keitel has brought into her legions that basically says women and men are equal, and yes, women in this instance for the Cabal, which, I don't know, seems like it would definitely be more of a patriarchal society, given the ancient Roman references, might actually be able to hold higher authority. It's really unclear, but we've got some really cool potential questions to answer here. And I think a lot of that may be revealed in some of the side references and writing of the lore. Also, You can see the boss in the background there. It's a little bit harder to see the tusks behind the bow, but yeah, there is a new exotic bow, and that's awesome. I really hope that this has some fun lore to it, but I guess we'll see. So we're going to go back to these new strikes here before we go into anything else. I say new strikes. These are returning strikes. For those of you that never played Destiny 1, hi, this would have been called Sepix Prime back in the day. Given that Omnigul has now been replaced with Navota, I would expect this to not be Sepix Prime, which effectively means this is not the old House of Devils servitor. It is more likely that this is a prime servitor that belongs to House Dusk. I don't believe it's a House Salvation asset, and the reason for that is very clearly because of the fact that House Salvation defiles its servitors, and this one is way too clean and pretty and round. It may be something that links back to the old House of Devils servitor. It may be a group of House Dusk that is trying to recreate the House of Devils, but ultimately, I think you're looking at something a bit different here. I think you're looking at something which is a Dusk asset that they've revived. Interesting little push, potentially. I stray towards the idea that we may be seeing a more united House Dusk here, though. And the reason I say that, and particularly House Dusk that is looking to reignite the assets of the House of Devils, is because of Fallen Saber here. This is, well, back in the day it would have been called Saber 2. Nowadays it may be something different. Was it Saber 2 or Saber 4? Either way, it's Saber. This is the first ever heavy shank module that we faced. And it comes armed with three different weapon platform modes, depending on which part of the strike you're in. And yeah, they are nasty. It's kind of a gnarly thing to face off against. So beware and do watch. Kind of scary to face off against this kind of heavy armor. Also, something I'm going to play very quickly for you. They have confirmed on the roadmap that there are going to be new stasis aspects, and I think that this is the one for the Revenant that we're about to see here. Take a look and see. Silence and Squall are about to be pulled out here. Silence, of course, is thrown first. It is immediately as a freeze. But look at what Squall does. I think this is how one of the aspects might change things. There's Silence. And Squall, instead of creating the whirlwind, now bounces between targets, and I imagine just does really big damage. So it's much more about your burst ad clear than it is about the typical crowd control this time. Very interesting. We've also got the champions, but the champions of the battleground activities and whatnot. This is where you'll face off against the different chosen. We'll go ahead and play that for you just now, though. So yeah, not much to see here aside from a few different weapons, really. We obviously had a Trials hand cannon here, considering the Osiris sight. Very nice to see that, even if it is effectively borrowing the Suros model here a little bit. We have an SMG and a rocket launcher. These seem to be taking a lot of inspiration from the rocket launchers that we got, and the weapons generally that we got back in the days of the Leviathan raid. But they seem much more sort of an in-between of the Cabal styles, you know? It's not pristine and shining like the Leviathan was, but it's not completely militaristic. It's this kind of gnarly middle ground, which creates a very... Honestly, this is a unique aesthetic for the Cabal entirely. The rocket launcher, not so much. I mean, you can even see the vague silhouette here of what would have one day have been Sands of the Past, the old rocket launcher from those times. It's kind of cool to see some of these details.
We need you, Guardian. Be our champion.
So, we're going to get back to this in a moment. Trust me. We're going to talk about this. We are absolutely going to talk about this, particularly about this, very much about this. Sorry, I need to point that out. Just a few fun things in these bits beforehand. The Cabal have taken over little bits of the landscape and turned them into fortresses. Either this ends up being a battleground, or this is just part of the season. No matter what happens, that's pretty cool. This all looks to be the new Trials gear, by the looks of things. Either that, or it's some kind of Eververse gear. In fact, I'm not 100% sure if it is the new Trials gear. I take all of that back. Regardless, you have some interesting motifs with each of them. The Hunters here are... well, they have a cloak that ends in a scorpion's tail, and Titans have a bullhead's helm. And it looks like wings on the back here, so maybe there's something going on with these star symbols. It could be that this is relating to a variety of different star signs. It may be that these aren't wings, but scales. So maybe you're looking at Pisces, Taurus, and Scorpio. I'm not 100% sure on that, but constellations would seem to indicate. Someone who's more versed in astrology... will probably give you more mileage out of that. Also, something nice to note, this right here looks like a Temptation's Hook in Solar. So we're getting more flavors of swords on that particular front. That's nice and fun. Anyway, we're going to move on. There you go. Just to point it out again, I'll just get a little bit of a better angle for you lot. Come on. There it is. The cloak is a scorpion's tail, which is really, really cool. Also, Vanguard weapons. Shadow Price, if I'm not mistaken. That's fun.
Be our champion.
I'll sharpen my gilded knife.
Yeah, Solar Temptations.
And see you both on the battlefield.
So, yeah. I don't know what Crow's involvement in this season is, but that is definitely Crow. There is no question about that being anyone else. It's unquestionably Crow. And the reason for it is this. This pattern of armor with the Warbeast scales is what he was wearing in Forsaken. It is what he may have been buried in when he died. It's probably his new set of armor, considering that he would have tossed off of all of the raiment that Spider had given him and now is under his own identity. The Hawkmoon mission has changed him. By the way, Hawkmoon video on Thursday. It's done and dusted. We're getting final edits in. You will learn, if you watch that video, how much Aldrin has changed. He is no longer Spider's tool. He's no longer Spider's lackey. I keep on calling Crow Aldrin. Yeah. Aldrin is dead. Crow is very much his own person. Yeah, this seems like it's gotta be Crow. And the fact that Crow is standing alongside Zavala during these negotiations is exciting. I also wanted to point something out here, something potentially of relevance. There is a Scion here, and there is a Scion who appears to be handing a weapon over to Keitel. And I have questions that whenever I see a Scion, and this is where I kind of want to bring in another part to this entire talk and this entire story. I said earlier that there were two very strong female leaders in the Cabal right now. And whilst one of them is Keitel, the other is a Cabal Scion known as Amtek. So whenever I see a Scion, I'm reminded of this. Admittedly, you know, you've got the Freeborn potentially out there as well, and all the different, you know, races that are subservient to the Cabal Empire, but... for the moment, we're going to focus on immediate story elements, and we're going to ignore Otzot and a few other things like that. We're talking about Keitel and potentially Amtek. Amtek is the fourth sister. If anybody remembers the Season of Dawn this time last year, you'll remember the Sundial activity. Sundial saw you facing off against three Scion sisters. Sundial in itself was kind of an awesome activity for the story gravity that it lent to Season of the Worthy, but it was not picked up on in terms of the story at all. Amtek, the sister who hurtles the Almighty at the city, yes, that was her doing, is barely spoken about in the lore. And if I'm looking for anything here, I am looking for Keitel and Amtek to just really flesh out their relationship in some way so that they can find a consensus of, yeah, we're against the Guardians. Either that, or Amtek can potentially be a foil to Keitel. You know, one of them driven by experience and a willingness to fight and do whatever is required for supremacy, and another driven by utter revenge. I'm not suggesting that this Scion is Amtek. This, for all we know, is just a regular old Scion who is just doing whatever. But it's worth keeping Amtek in mind. And this is what this entire scene really reminds me of. So, yeah.
And see you both on the battlefield.
We have quite a few nice freeze frames to go through there. So regardless of whether it's new finishers and what's going on here, which I think is what you're seeing with the Warlock and obviously with the Hunter here, we have a Scion enemy. This is clearly one of the Chosen, and this is what I wanted to point out. This is why I think Amtek may be of some kind of relevance. And I say that knowing that this could just be another random Scion. But if Amtek does make an appearance here, that's either a cap to the storyline or it's a continuation of it. Because it can always be the case that one of these bosses can escape. You know, like Bungie doesn't always have to give us the kill. There can be some shenanigans where they appear in a strike and aren't actually killed. That's doable as long as there's an actual story purpose to it. Either way, this looks like an activity we'll be getting up to on Nessus. So very exciting stuff. Gosh, that's a very bright shot right there. Very bright shot, but it looks like that's a finisher where a guardian is throwing the shield out. That's kind of cool. Look at that, that's neat. Also, do note, in keeping with traditional, notions of enemy design, whenever there is a new enemy faction of note in the system, they have their own aesthetic to all the different units, and this is very clearly Keitel's Chosen Legion. And their aesthetic of the sort of black and blue and some ornamentation, not callous levels of ornamentation, but still. Exciting things. Oh, and one last thing. Sorry, I know I keep going back because all these things keep happening. This also looks like Mercury. Isn't that neat? It's probably Nessus because this is the interior of the planet core here. So I bet we're just going to go down into the planet core bit, but yay, it's our good old friend Palindrome. Look at that. That's fun. I haven't used my Palindrome in years. It'll be good to kill some dudes in Crucible again with that. But yeah, last thing I need to show you is going to be something that I will repeat and get the frames for a few times.
There's no light here.
Did you see it? First of all, we have... No, hang on. Let's try that again. Oh, thank God I got it first time. Yeah, first of all, this is a Screeb. I don't know why there's a Screeb here. But it is a Screeb. It looks like a Screeb that is on a Cabal ship. You can see these angled hallways here are very typical of a Cabal ship, especially the military classes. It's not unknown for them to have all this clutter around on them. The floor is definitely exemplary of that. It may be that this is a expedition that has been lost in space somewhere within the darkness-controlled space. Something else, I don't know if this is a full Leviathan symbol or something, but it kind of looks like one. Here at the top, you see the circle there and some kind of line here. It looks as though we're missing a line in this side, so I wonder and I doubt. But yeah, also, let's see if I can get it. No, hi, there's our friend. Ooh, there's an even closer shot. Hi, you are terrifying. Good God, wow. You are ugly. Ugly. I'm going to do this until I eventually get it. I'm sure that I'll grab it at some point. It's all the problem with individual frames on YouTube. Oh, no, there's our Screeb friend again. Well, hallelujah. It only took us unfull-screening it. We have a whole bunch of Cabal text. There are in fact multiple frames of different Cabal text. This may be some kind of clue. And I'm going to go ahead and throw this out there. This might be decipherable, but I don't necessarily know if it is completely decipherable, and here is why. We know that Cabal use a decimal system of counting just like we humans do. We know this because of the scope for the one exotic scout rifle that is basically just a Cabal slug rifle. Skyburner's Oath, that's the name of it. And we actually can see the Cabal decimals from 0 to 9 on there, which means that we can count in Cabal. If these are not letters and are instead numbers, which some of them might be, some of them might not be, this is more likely to be close to what a number might be. Things like this, which are much more complex, might be something like a word or even just a complicated letter with some kind of annotation to it. Regardless, we might be able to partially decode some of this, especially if some of the lore gives us hints as to what the Cabal script really is. One of these days, we may get a Rosetta Stone for the Cabal language, and when that happens, we might actually be able to decode all of this stuff in front of us. In the meantime, what is this? Well, Osiris states there is no light here, and this is a Cabal ship that's clearly lost in space. It's lost in space around the reef. I sense that there may well be some kind of hive shenanigans here, but I feel like the much more likely point is the darkness has taken this ship. And why is that? Well, there is a really big point about what the darkness has done to the other planets in the system and planetoids that disappeared, namely Mercury, Mars, Titan, and Io. Basically, what it appears to have done is it has wrapped them in a field by which they kind of cease to exist within our reality. Asher Mir has a few different explorations of this back when he was on Io. He basically launched a series of projectiles at the pyramid, and it was basically holding them, those projectiles, when they got launched at it. It blipped them out of existence and is just holding them there in stasis. Something like this and a larger effect may have happened to the ship. It may indeed have happened to the planets that the darkness consumed back in the season that we saw them arrive in, the season of arrivals. So yeah, it's not totally clear what's going on here, but I suspect darkness nonsense of some kind. Why there is a Scrieb in all of this, I don't know. But our terrifying friend, I'm sure, will be there to greet us at some point. And yeah, whatever the reason is behind all of this, I'm sure it will be equally terrifying. So yeah, there's that. Yeah, Season of the Chosen. It's coming February 9th, and the next season is coming May 12th, May 11th. May 11th, I guess, because you take over on the same day? Yeah. Either way, new season's coming along. Keitel is the big story of all of this. There will inevitably be more lore. It's very exciting to see all of this stuff go down. Let me know your thoughts down below in the comments section, and thank you for listening to me witter about Destiny stuff on this live commentary for what has been nearly 30 minutes now. So yeah, I will catch you guys in a bit. Adios. As always, my name is Bife. Por audacia ad astra. I'll see you starside.